was a good trick question. Like, you sort of look at your games against Iowa, too, and since they don't change much from year to year, though, is it a good plan for a game like this?
Yeah, we look at all of it. We probably want to move farther away from these guys in the future. We look at all of it. We go back and watch, obviously, our games, especially because there hasn't been turnover on the staff, their staff, but they're also looking at us differently because we've had some changes. But, yeah, we look at it all. We go back and obviously look at the games from this year, look at the late games from last season, bowl game, and then obviously, you know, our previous games. Usually on special teams, you have a lot less kind of reps to evaluate. So that's where you really will dig back a couple years, especially if it's been the same coordinator.
James, Kaylee King burned his red shirt on Saturday. Yeah, you set a high bar for him back in the spring. What has he done since that point to kind of continue validating the early success that he had?
Yeah, you know, he's still a true freshman that's getting better, and he makes plays, and he's extremely competitive, but there's still things that he needs to learn. You know, to have a chance to get significant playing time and kind of make the move there, just in terms of the level of consistency. That's really what it's about. It's who do the coaches and their peers feel like has earned the right to consistently be out there based on their actions. And Kalen's done some really good things as a young player through spring ball and through training camp and even for this season. But he just needs to do it on a more consistent basis. And then I think the other thing that we're trying to get through to a lot of these young guys is special teams. You guys have heard me tell the story 1,000 times, but Grant Haley, as a young player, gained a lot of his confidence through special teams as his defensive reps grew. And that's what I'd like to see for Kalen. Kalen should be starting on 3 units on special teams right now, but he's not. And that's something I think that you know, he can work on.
James, Iowa's offense doesn't score a whole bunch, they score a whole bunch, but they don't move the ball very much. Are you putting an extra emphasis on field position this game?
Well, yeah, that's because of the turnovers that they get. So they're in a great situation because they're doing what they can do with the opportunities they get. They get the ball in short fields, and they've been able to turn them into touchdowns. So, you know, that's a positive for them. It's hard for me to kind of talk about more than that because they have done what they've needed to do with the situation that they've been in.
James, along those lines, we see you guys working on ball security every time we're at practice. Is that amped up at all this week facing an opponent that's forced so many turnovers, or is there more of a getting the message across?
No, we literally, and I've never, any other place I've ever been, except obviously at Vanderbilt and here, we do a specific ball security drill every single day, always have. There's always times where the coordinators will come to me and say, hey, you know, during that period today, I'd like to do this or do that. That's a non-negotiable. There's a lot of things that we'll discuss and modify. That's not one of them. So we continue to emphasize it. But no, it's not different this week. I have talked about it in the meeting, that's been a huge part of their success this season, and a big reason why they are where they are. So we've talked about that, but nothing in practice has really been different.
Is it going to be weird going back out on the road again, first time in a while? Just in pumping in the crowd noise as well, just that environment on Saturday.
No, it's been how many weeks? 2-3 weeks?
Been home for 4.
Huh?
Been home for 4.
Oh, well, I guess it has been long. Yeah. Yeah. I don't know. We're just, no, not really.
James, if I could go back, I don't want to assume anything, but it doesn't seem like you're trending towards burning a lot of red shirts with this freshman class. Does it feel a little bit different than freshman classes in years past in terms of that volume, and how does that maybe impact personnel plans moving forward when that many guys preserve a year of eligibility?
Yeah, I'm not sure. It's interesting. Sometimes you guys will ask questions, and it triggers kind of a thought for me. I want to go back and look at that this year compared to previous years. I'm not sure on that. I think a little bit too is the way our schedule played out. You know, we typically would have different out of conference games to open the season. We got one of the most challenging schedules in college football. so that may factor into it, but I'm not sure. I wouldn't necessarily say that this freshman class feels different than others. I think a lot of it is the schedule, but I it triggers a thought that I want to go back and kind of study this class compared to the last few.
What are the triggers for you going to a game with a plan for how you want to attack a defense or an offense, and it doesn't work, or it does work, but then you're down by 14 and running the ball doesn't make sense anymore because there's 5 minutes left? What are the triggers for we're changing our approach to what we're doing in the middle of a game, and how do you get a team ready for those moments?
Yeah. I think that's a good question. You know, in terms of getting the team ready for it, besides 4 minute and 2 minute when it distinctly changes, I'm not. I don't know if we necessarily do that, and I don't even know if we necessarily want them to know that. We would just manage that from the sideline and how we call the games or when we get the plays in or the type of tempos that we use. So 4 minute and 2 minute specifically, we're doing that. Besides that, we're trying to manage it as coaches. Obviously being on the road has elements, but yeah, I think that's something that we'll try to more manage. I don't really want the players kind of understanding some of those things. I just want them going out and compete.
Okay, so we've seen Mike Yurcich, you know, step out there and play quarterback a few times in practice. How does his hands-on approach kind of work with this offense?
I'm not following what you mean about playing quarterback. I haven't.
Cornerback.
Oh, cornerback.
Yeah.
Yeah. No. There's sometimes he'll jump in. Say. And that's not very different than in years past. But say we're running a certain play and the scout team guy didn't do it exactly like what Iowa is going to do on Saturday. Rather than take the time to explain it, he'll pull him out and jump in and give the look, or Taylor or whoever it may be. But yeah, he's been hands-on, but I would say we've been in that situation really since I've been here.
What's something that surprised or maybe impressed you most with Mike in this offense?
Yeah, I wouldn't, not to kind of give you a short answer, but I wouldn't necessarily say anything's really surprised me.
What's impressive?
You know, he's a creative guy and loves plays. I know that sounds somewhat ridiculous as an offensive coordinator, but he loves plays. So I think his creativity and his ability to complement and set up one play to the next week, I think has been really good, really good. His intensity, I think, has been really good for us. You know, I think we're going to continue to get better each week, and part of it is really the staff getting used to Mike and Mike getting used to the staff and the type of communication that happens from the booth down to him and then from the sideline as well. But, you know, so far, obviously, so good. But I still think there's a lot of room left for growth, and I think Mike would feel the same way.
James. Speaking of that, there's always the adage of take what the defense gives you, but they're giving it to you for a reason. How do you, as the head coach, kind of teach that or give that to your offensive coordinator and your quarterback, knowing when to be aggressive?
Yeah, and I think you guys have heard me say this in years past, where that's where I think my past of being a play caller, so having a kind of understanding of that and being able to be on the sideline and watch the flow of the game. And sometimes you're so close to something, so hearing a different perspective is good sometimes. It's kind of reminding, hey, you know, we need to push the ball down the field, or they haven't stopped the run yet. Let's get back to the run, or things like that. And I've always done that with the coordinators, is reminding them. Or you had some plays that you were successful with in the first quarter, the first half, and we haven't gone back to it. You know, things like that. So that's what I try to do as much as I possibly can with Brent, with Mike, with Joe as well. But he's been great. You know, he's been great. Did I answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay.
James, you have a couple of assistants, former assistants, who are facing each other this weekend in Huff and Ricky.
Yep.
Do you keep tabs on those guys and watch their progress? And how much pride do you take in seeing former
assistants? Yeah. Yeah, it's been really cool to see guys leave here and become head coaches or go to the NFL or whatever it may be. I mean, that's part of my responsibility as well, too, right? It's to help the players reach their dreams. It's also to put, you know, a product on the field that our fans and alumni and Letterman can be proud of. But it's also to help these guys' careers and whatever they may want to do. So to see those two guys playing each other this week is cool. I went into Jevin's office to kind of look at the weekly highlight, and he was watching Ricky's press conference, and it kind of rewinded and showed me a couple things, you know, that Ricky had said. So it's cool. I think this is the first, you know, two former staff members going against each other and having success. It's also interesting with the staff, you know, they're opening press conferences and the staff will bring up things that kind of showed up in the press conference. I'm happy for both of those guys. Those guys are both really good football coaches. Those guys are both really good recruiters. And they're really good men. And, you know, it'll be interesting to see how this one plays out. Obviously, it's weird because it's for both of them, if I'm correct here, it's both of them their first year coaching games, but Ricky's second year being a head coach. I know that sounds strange, but I think that's the reality of it.
James, we're going to get Jair Brown here in just a moment. How has he answered the bell since you guys named him the starter, and what has he done to impact the defense these last five games?
Yeah, Tig's been, you know, phenomenal. And I think his improvement, like a lot of junior college players, from year one to year two, I think has been dramatic. But more than that, I'm a big Tig fan. He's very appreciative, coming from Trenton, New Jersey, and from Lackawanna Junior College. He's very appreciative of his opportunities and experience here at Penn State. He's always got a huge smile on his face. He's one of those guys that I think does a really good job of being a great teammate, but also understanding how to be with the coaches and is coachable, but also can have fun, you know, with the coaches as well. I know him and Coach Poindexter have a great relationship. I'm really proud of him. I spoke with Coach Duda today and just told him how great Tig is doing. I'm really happy. I'm not surprised at the success that he's having this year. I think we got two of the better safeties in college football.
How does having a consistent effort on punt change what you do, if at all? Like, how does it give you confidence when Jordan's back there doing what he does so consistently?
Yeah, that's where the discussion sometimes comes is, we're doing such a good job of sky punts and things like that where, you know, should we go for it on fourth down in plus territory or should we pin them deep? The analytics people will tell you should go for it on every single fourth down, but I do think it has to factor in, which I don't know if they do, how good is your punter at pinning people deep and how good are your bullets at playing the ball in the air? So I think that helps. Hopefully we're not in a situation where we have to swing field position, but he's shown he's been able to do that. And some punters will do it, but they don't do it with hang time, and it becomes a negative. You actually out kick your coverage, and he's been able to kick it for, you know, tremendous distance and swing field position, but also do it in a way where we have a chance to cover it with field position as well as hang time.
Thanks, Coach.
Yeah. Thanks, guys.
Thanks.